This is Holy Trinity, Anglican Church, Vancouver.
Please turn to page 1086 in the Church Bibles, Acts chapter 26. I was born in 1963. That places me at the tail end of the so-called baby boomers. After that have come Generation X, Millennials, Generation Z, and Generation Alpha. Added to which, I find myself in Canada and in the Vancouver subgenre of that. Is it any wonder that at times I find myself somewhat at sea, culturally speaking? What is the true nature of education and what is its value? My parents put a lot of store in education for my sister and me, and I inherited from them a respect for educational institutions. Now, though, I'm not so sure. Times have changed. On the one hand, there seems to be an obsession with paper qualifications. But on the other hand, one mustn't be thought of as too cerebral, because it's feelings that count. What do we end up with? Perhaps feelings-based qualifications. The Roman governor, Festus, tells Paul, verse 24, "You are out of your mind. Your great learning is driving you insane." I wish I'd been there to see that. Indeed, we're told that Festus shouted. Paul keeps his cool. Verse 25. "I am not insane, most excellent Festus," Paul replied. "What I am saying is true and reasonable." True and reasonable. I'll put that alongside other terms such as beyond reasonable doubt and clear and present danger. Except nowadays, you're likely to be told that truth is flexible and relative, and reason gives way to emotion. But Paul stakes his case squarely on the grounds of truth and reasonableness. Perhaps this is a reason why people can find Paul unpalatable nowadays. These are the facts as we have received them. These are the truths that the Christian believes. This is the basis of all of our preaching. Christ died for sinners and rose from the tomb. I am a Christian because I believe that Christianity is true. If I didn't believe it to be true, I wouldn't be a Christian. I'm not a Christian because it makes me feel good. At times it might have this effect on me, but at other times it doesn't. If my Christianity depended on feelings, it would be forever switching on and off. No, I am a Christian because I believe that Christ died for sinners and rose from the tomb. This is the basis of all of our preaching. These are the truths that the Christian believes. In January last year, Brian Bird wrote an article in the Vancouver Sun. It was headed, "The ban on in-person worship continues in BC, along with the wait for a compelling reason why." These two responses from readers were not atypical. Religion poisons everything. Belief in imaginary sky gods is a mental disease. Faith is just a self-imposed vulnerability, but allows those with an agenda to take advantage of your lack of critical thinking. Let's face it, the motivation behind some people wishing the churches closed was that they wanted them closed for good. Talk about having an agenda. To their mind, they had the science on their side, and anything that didn't fit in with this must be imaginary. As I said last week, Christianity is essentially otherworldly. Yet it's an other world that breaks through into ours. Paul says, verse 26, "The king is familiar with these things, and I can speak freely to him. I am convinced that none of this has escaped his notice, because it was not done in a corner." Done in a corner, meaning hidden from view, in secret. But none of this was done secretly. These things, Jesus' ministry, his death and resurrection, happened where everyone could see them. Imaginary? I don't think so. The Bible is different from all other religious literature. What is the Quran? It's a hodgepodge of aspects of Christianity and Judaism put together by a man in a cave, Muhammad. Talking of Christian heresies, Mormonism has Joseph Smith with his golden plates, now lost. By contrast, Christianity is based on real events on the table of history, events that were witnessed by others, by many people. Paul says, this isn't an irrational thing. It's not a made-up thing. It's hard facts, real history, public truth. Verse 28. Then Agrippa said to Paul, "Do you think that in such a short time you can persuade me to be a Christian?" A curious question. How long does Agrippa think it should take? It makes Christianity sound like baking a cake, place in the oven, and leave for X hours. Paul replied, verse 29, "Short time or long, I pray God that not only you, but all who are listening to me today may become what I am, except for these chains." Can Paul make Agrippa a Christian? No. Paul says, "I pray God." It's an act of God, specifically the Holy Spirit, that makes people Christian. Paul is only a messenger. I am only a messenger. You are only a messenger when you tell people the good news of Jesus Christ. You play an essential part, but so does the Holy Spirit. Paul says, "I pray God, but not only you, but all who are listening to me today may become what I am, a follower of Jesus Christ as Lord and Saviour." Is that what you are? And who have you told about it? Today's culture delights in pointing out the perceived failures of the past. By contrast, how lucky we are to live now when everything is perfect, or soon will be, when we've dispensed with the pesky churches for good. Are the Christians intolerant? No. I think the boot's well and truly on the other foot. You don't have to check your brain at the door in order to be a Christian. All you have to do is to believe in the truth. Things that actually happened to a real person, Jesus, in front of real people, many witnesses. Strangely enough, that's what I would call following the science. Amen.
Sinner stands a tremble.